Coal and nuclear, two energy sources I don't think go together well. In fact, I see one as a means to end the other. And therefore, I must speak my mind. I've been quiet on this subject because I had to think about it very carefully. First, let me show you what is going on and what is the reason for this video. The Department of Energy in the United States is planning on introducing new subsidies for coal and nuclear energy. These subsidies are meant to keep coal and nuclear facilities operational where they would otherwise be shut down, perhaps even prematurely. I'm not a big fan of this way of thinking. It's not a solution-based proposal. It's more of the same, really. However, it is essential to keep extant nuclear capacity running. But it is not a long-term solution, as it does not guarantee that new capacity will be built, and that should be the main focus. Having said that, first let me acknowledge the basic problem behind the US energy system. It's mostly based on cost competitiveness. And by offering subsidies and rebates and credits, the market has become unfavorable for nuclear power plants. Despite heavy investments in renewable technologies and wishful thinking concerning energy storage, the big winner in the US is still fossil-fueled electricity generation, i.e. coal and gas. As we speak, gas has the upper hand. It has gotten a new lease on life thanks to the so-called fracking boom. Fracking is a shorthand for hydraulic fracturing, which means that you pump a liquid into porous rock and fracture it to release the natural gas that it is contained within. It turns out that the volume of retrievable gas in the US is so great that the price for natural gas has plummeted. This turns to be true almost everywhere on the planet. Natural gas is not a good replacement for coal nor for nuclear. Some would say that gas burns cleaner than coal, and that's true. But it still isn't free from NOx emissions nor adverse effects on the climate. In fact, if gas leakages occur, they have the propensity to kick the temperature up even more. So, we have this unholy alliance between renewables and natural gas, which is the so-called competitive side of the energy market. And coal, and let's be honest, stagnant nuclear, on the other hand. And this is a problem. This is a status quo that must be broken. I would support this plan if there were two separate proposals, one for coal and one for nuclear, because then it would be possible to eliminate one without the other. It would add legal resilience for nuclear, and it would not create the illusion that coal and nuclear are linked and inseparable. If you would ask me, there are three considerations. First, the nuclear industry must be reinvigorated. Keeping extant reactor facilities open is essential. However, there are so many proposals to propel the US into a new age of technological discovery when nuclear energy is concerned, that for those to flourish, there too, new incentives must flow. And these may even be needed now more than ever. Second, neither natural gas nor coal is a good match for either technology. Giving subsidies to coal will only serve to keep coal burning going on with all the negative effects associated with them, even death caused by continued emissions. Third, renewable and nuclear should be considered natural allies, as they both have low carbon emission profiles. Also, because most technological advances may be found in technical research for both technologies. This means that if we open regulatory and research pathways for nuclear developments as well as keeping extant plants like Diablo Canyon running, we could truly start bringing an end to the use of fossil fuels for energy. So yes, a part of the effort of the DOE under the Trump administration may do some good, but I cannot ignore the bad. Keeping open coal, in my opinion, is not an option and should not be included. Before we end this video, I have some interesting news. First, in lieu with the entire Jacobson versus Clack and Pines debacle, I've been re-examining Jacobson's thesis, and I think that I have discovered a new fundamental shortcoming, but I'm still struggling with some levelized cost analysis. One of my findings is that in terms of capital cost, current nuclear outclasses renewables by a great margin the further you extrapolate out into the future. Second, take some time to read the Roadmap to Nowhere. It is freely available and the link is currently showing on the screen. Here's the blurb Tim Maloney, one of the authors, sent me. The Roadmap to Nowhere is an easy-to-read, entertaining, and comprehensive explainer that tackles Professor Mark Jacobson's popular 50-state renewables roadmap, a 35-year strategy for a nationwide clean energy grid. Using everyday non-technical language and graphics, this book challenges everything you thought you knew about one of today's most important debates, renewables versus nuclear energy. End of quote. Both of these authors are great friends of mine. After years of email contact, we finally met in St. Louis earlier this year. Read their free online book and share it with as many people as you can, because we will benefit from it. And third, I finally started writing my fourth book. It will revolve around the ongoing 100% renewable discussion. I'm going to hone in on people like Bill McKibben, Naomi Oreskes, Naomi Klein, and on the other hand, James Hansen, Ken Caldera, Christopher Clack, Michael Schellenberger, and many more. Additionally, I will shed some light on the UNEP matter at COP23 earlier this year. This book will be less technical than the previous one. I know that it is a bee under my bonnet, but to be honest with you, there is not a single subject more important. If we succeed to create a future where everybody gets to live a life of plenty and security, then this discussion has stood at its root. Thank you all for watching and have a nice day.